for a really long time. Great question, Story. Thank you. Got a question up front? We're going to keep you running here, Pastor.
I need some exercise. Where are we at?
Right up here. And your name is?
Emma.
Emma, nice to meet you.
After you ever did like those mean things to Alex, did you ever regret it after?
Oh man. So if you couldn't hear Emma, her question is, after I said those and did those mean things to Alex, did I ever regret it? I really did regret it. I really did. I felt really bad and I told him I was sorry. And I'll tell you something that happened after that. We were in the same gym class, and one day during gym, he said, and we were juniors in high school, so I guess we were like 16 years old, maybe 16, 17 years old. During gym class, he said, hey, I need to show you something. And so I walked over, and he pulled out of his pocket a bunch of pills. It turns out he was taking drugs. And he said, I'm hooked on these things, and I haven't told anybody. You're the first person I told. And so I really felt that he trusted me, you know, because I'd apologized to him and we had become friends. And I was able to help him get some help for this drug problem that he was developing. So sometimes, you know, you can really make a big mistake with somebody, and then you tell them you're sorry, you try to make it right, and then something good can come out of it. It's a great question. Thanks, Emma. And yes, right here.
Camden?
Camden?
Yeah.
Good to meet you.
When did you become a pastor?
Okay, that's a tricky story, Camden. So I became a college English teacher, and I was teaching at a university of Maryland. And I got married, and my wife and I started having a dinner at our house. I think we started on Thursday nights, and then we switched it to Monday or something. But we started having dinner once a week at our house, and we would make soup and homemade bread. And I'd invite four or five people over. My wife might invite, so we'd have like six, eight people sitting around a table in our little apartment. We'd be crammed in, and we started having dinner, and we would just talk about life and maybe talk about God, and then. Some people would hear about it and they'd say, well, you don't have any more room for dinner, but why don't you come at 7 after dinner? And then we would talk. Well, pretty soon we had 35 people coming to this thing in our little apartment. And then somebody said, well, we have a basement, so we could use their basement. So we got up to 50 people, then 70 people. That actually became a little church. And so I was involved with it from the very beginning. But then we hired somebody else to be our pastor, and he was our pastor for a couple years, and then he said he didn't feel he should be a pastor anymore, and so that's when I became the pastor. So it was sort of an unusual path into that, and I did that for 24 years, long time. So one in the back, we're going to really keep the pastor running now. Let's keep this up. We'll keep the pastor moving as much as we can. What's your name?
Ian.
Hi, Ian.
Mm-hmm.
Good to meet you.
Do you still have Jews coming to your church till this day?
So I'm not a pastor now. I don't go to that. I'm not part of that church anymore because I live in a different state. But you know that guy I told you about? I think he still goes there. And he's growing, and he would call, if you said, what religion are you? He'd say, well, I was born a Jew, and I still go to synagogue, but he'd say, I often get a second opinion on Sundays. And so he feels he's welcome in two different communities. I kind of like that. Does that answer your question? Great question, Ian. And see, this is the thing. We can really make space for people. In fact, I'll just tell you, since we're in a Lutheran church, and I'm sure you have people from many different backgrounds, I'll just tell you a quick story about this. I have a friend who's a Lutheran pastor. Now he's here in Minnesota, but he used to live in Encino, California. And an older lady in the church, she came to church, but her husband had no religion. He never came to church. And she died. And at the funeral, her husband came up to the pastor and said, I didn't go to this church, but I really know how much it meant to my wife, and I want to do something nice for the church. And so he pulled out a checkbook, and he wrote a check for $1,000, and he said, I would like you to use this check to get an environmental audit of the building, because this guy really cared about the environment, and he cared about global warming and things like that. So he wrote a check for $1,000 to get an environmental audit. Well, they paid some company, and they did an audit of their church building. And here's what they found out. The church spent $40,000 a year on electricity. And they found out through this audit that their roof was just perfect, that they could put solar panels on the roof and pay for the entire electric bill. But the solar panels would cost $130,000. So the pastor went back to the guy and said, well, we got the audit. Here's what they told us. The guy pulled out his checkbook and wrote a check for $130,000. Not many of us could do that, but this guy could. Says, I want you to get it. So that now they never have to pay an electric bill for 20, 30 years or more, as long as it lasts, which is a huge gift to the church, you know, and it's a pretty good investment when you spread that over how much money that saves. Plus, now the church can start to do all kinds of great things with that money that they're not spending on the electric bill. But what's even better than that is like five families in the church said, wow, they saved a lot of money by doing that, and it's really good for the environment. And because we're Christians, we care about the earth, because the earth is precious, and we got to take care of the earth. So they, five families said, well, we're going to do it too. And so then they got it on their roofs. And then five more families heard about it, and they said, well, we'll do it too. And it's just been this kind of neat thing that was all started by a guy who was only sort of, he wasn't part of the church, but he was close to the church. And I think it's just to me a good example of how sometimes we realize that we have all kinds of connections that of people who don't even consider themselves part of the church, but yet we can work together in some beautiful ways. I want to see if there's one more question from a student, or we can hear from students anytime, and then if somebody else has a question too. Anything else from any of the students who are here? Can we just have a round of applause for those excellent questions? And of course, if any of the students want to ask another question, feel free, but I want to open it up for anybody who wants to ask something. We have somebody in the back.
Thanks for coming. My name's Keith.
Hi, Keith.
So one of the verses that I think has created hostility in the Christian faith is John 14:6.
Yes.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And I think that's one of the, yeah, it's one of those things that cause division, that makes us think we're right, you're wrong.
Yes.
How do you handle that?
I'm really glad you asked that. And I forgot your name. Say it again.
What's that?
Say your name again.
Keith.
Keith. Okay, so for anyone who doesn't know that verse, it's John 14:6. And the verse says, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. So I want to tell you a quick story about that, Keith. There is a brilliant Muslim writer in the United States named Eboo Patel. Eboo has written a number of books. Have any of you read any of Eboo's books? Yeah, several of you. He's a really good writer, wonderful guy. He started an organization called Interfaith Youth Corps. And what they do is they get mostly college students, but some high school and older students. They get Jews and Muslims and Christians and Buddhists, and they get them to serve together, to work for the common good together. It's a great organization. Eboo's a friend of mine. We met one time, and you know how when you're really deep in conversation with somebody, like you'll be in a coffee shop, and then you keep talking, and you go to one of the person's car, and so we go to Eboo's car because he's got to go, and then we walk over to my car and keep talking, and then we walk back to his car, and our conversation just kept going. And at one point I said to Eboo, you Muslims, you are so far ahead of us. I said, you're so lucky. He says, what do you mean? I said, whenever I talk to a Muslim about relationships between Muslims and people of other faiths, they always quote this verse from the Quran. And here's the verse. God says, we made you humans different so that you would seek to understand and know each other. God made you different so you would seek to know and understand each other. I said, that's such a great verse. I said, Ibu, whenever you talk to a Christian about what about people of other faiths, they always quote John 14:6. And Ibu says, oh, believe me, I've heard that verse many times. People told me I'm going to hell because of John 14:6, because I'm a Muslim. He said, but Brian, the question you've got to ask, here's what he said. But Brian, you've got to remember, there are a lot of other verses in the Quran that are not so friendly as that one that people quoted you. I got to admit that. He says, there's a lot of unfriendly verses in the Quran. He says, but here's the question. Why do Muslims quote the friendly verse, and why do Christians quote the most unfriendly verse they can? You see his point? And I said, well, I guess it's because our religious leaders taught our people to quote that verse. He says, that's the real issue. Why do Christians teach people that that's the verse to quote? So let me say something about the verse, and then I want to come back to Ibu's question. John 14:6 is part of a passage where Jesus is about to die, and he says to the disciples, I'm going somewhere. Where I'm going, you know, and the way, you know. And the disciples are like, we have no idea what you're talking about. We don't know where you're going. We don't know the way. We have no idea what you're talking about. And then he says, I am the way. You understand? John 14:5 is not, and Philip came to Jesus and said, what about people of other religions? And Jesus said, no, it's not. It's a question the disciples are asking. We have no idea what you're talking about. Where are you going, and what is the way? I am the way. So the first thing I would say about that verse is, it has nothing to do with people of other religions. This is a discussion between Jesus and his disciples. And I think that's important. If we wanted to go deeper into it, it plays into a theme in the Gospel of John that begins in about chapter 6, might be chapter 7. The first time where Jesus says, I'm going somewhere and you won't be able to find me. And they think, what is he talking about? Where is he going? What's this all about? And this keeps coming back again and again in John. I'm going somewhere. You won't be able to follow me. I'm going somewhere. You can't find me. And it becomes clear that what Jesus is saying is, I know I'm going to die. I know I'm going to be killed. And so it plays into that whole theme in the Gospel of John. But let me say two other things about that verse. If we wanted to apply that verse to this question of people of other religions, again, it's not what the chapter is about, but if we wanted to apply it, here's how I think it would apply. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Philip says, show us the Father, and that'll be enough for us. Jesus says, Philip, have I been with you so long, and you don't understand? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. So here's what Jesus is saying is, look, if you understand me, if you see me, you see what God is like. So here's my question. How many people did Jesus kill? How many people did Jesus torture? How many people did Jesus reject? How many people did Jesus turn away? He turned away nobody. So Jesus is saying, if you've seen me, you've seen the way I love everybody, no exceptions, that's what God is like. Now here's the irony. If that's what Jesus is saying, and then Christians use that verse to say, God's going to kick you out unless you join our religion, it makes no sense at all. So there's a lot more we could say about the theology of that verse. But here, going back to Ibu's question, he said there are a lot of other verses that you could quote from the Bible. And so here's the interesting, try this. What if when somebody said, what about people of other religions? What if we decided to quote 1 John 4:6? Beloved, let us love one another. For everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. be a whole different story if we quoted that verse instead. We could quote a verse from Romans chapter 2 that says, whoever knows the law will be evaluated by the law, and whoever doesn't won't be evaluated by the law. In other words, you're evaluated based on what you know. So, and when people use that John 14:6 to say, doesn't matter as long as you aren't a part of our religion. And of course, that's not what John 14:6 says. Jesus doesn't say, we're going to start a religion and name it after me, and whoever doesn't belong to this religion, God's going to torture forever. It doesn't say that, and it's not in John at all. So a lot more we could say about that verse, but it's just the wrong verse to quote when this issue comes up. Many Christians quote it. But look, we all know this. You can use the Bible, you can misuse the Bible to say just about anything. So just quoting a Bible verse doesn't solve the problem, especially when you're quoting it to address something it never even addressed in its original context. So it's a great question. Thanks for asking that. Couple more? We don't want the pastor to get lazy back there. So, yes.
Hi, Brian. My name is Ruthie Schultz.
Hi. Did you say Ruthie?
Ruthie, yeah.
Hi, Ruthie.
You mentioned earlier that some people found you to be very controversial. And before I came tonight, I Googled you because I wanted to find out something more about you.
Yes.
And in fact, there were people out there on the internet who think you are very scary. Yeah.
Now you know why.
Yeah, that was like... So what would you say to those people to bridge that hostility?
Yes. Yeah, that's a great question. Ruthie, you're bringing back to my memory. I've only been to Norway one time, and a lot of you I know have Norwegian ancestors. I spoke in Oslo, and then I was supposed to speak in another city called, I won't pronounce it correctly, Stavanger. Is that, did I say it right? Stavanger? Okay, somebody said it correctly. Anyhow, I was supposed to go in that city. And it's I think the second biggest city in Norway, but it's not that big. And so it turns out you don't have to be very famous to get on the front page of the paper. So they sent a reporter to come interview me. And this poor reporter wasn't religious, but he just got assigned to this American who was coming. I felt sorry for the guy. So I have to meet with this guy. And he sits down with me at the table, turns on his little tape recorder, and he pulls out a file folder. He says, I'm very nervous about this interview. I said, I hope I'm not too intimidating. He said, I Googled you last night. And then he opens up his file, he's printed up, did you know you are the son of Satan? So, so the thing I would say is some people, they're deeply invested in an understanding of Christian faith that has clear lines that we're in, they're out. We're of God, they're of the devil. That sort of in-out way of thinking. And they're deeply, deeply invested in that. And the way they see it is they see that anyone who doesn't hold that view is a dangerous and evil person. And so, if a person wants to feel that way, I don't want to argue with them. It's fine with me if they feel that way. That's the way they need to judge me based on what they've been taught. What I'll try to do is treat them with respect, be a human being to them. I'll try to show them the love of Christ. If they ask me a question, I'll try to give them an honest answer. And we'll see where it goes from there. But, you know, one of the things that's really interesting to me about Jesus said, it's one of the most important and interesting things Jesus said, and it's very relevant to this issue. He said, I want you to be perfect the way your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, here's the problem. When we say the word perfect, we think like technical perfection, you know, like an ice skater who gets a 10 out of 10 or something. It's interesting. The word that Jesus used, that translated into Greek, is means mature or fully formed. I want you to be mature or fully formed the way God is. And here's how he defined it. God lets the sun and rain fall on evil people's fields and on good people's fields. God loves everybody, respective of how they behave. Can I say it this way? God's love is non-discriminatory. God loves everybody, not because they're good or bad, but because God is loving. It's who God is. And I want to try to love people that way. I fall far short. I mess up a lot. But that's my aspiration. I want to learn to love people that way. I think that's what Jesus actually taught. I think it's what he actually demonstrated. But, you know, we Christians have done a lot of different things that don't exactly fit in with Jesus. We're doing a lot of them even today in our country. And so, you know, so I understand. So, and then right in that context, Jesus said, love your enemies. And what's interesting to me about that is if somebody wants to define themselves as your enemy, you can't change them. If they want to be your enemy, they can be your enemy. Your job is to still love them, even if they don't return the favor. You start preemptively with love, and that's, I think, the only thing I can do in that situation. Sometimes people need reassurance. You know, they've been, a lot of people who have the worst things to say about me have never actually read any of my books. They just read what somebody wrote on the internet. So if I get to talk to them, I say, well, look, I hope you'll read one of my books, and then you can find out if you really agree or not. And maybe, you know, we can at least think together and maybe challenge each other. So thanks for that question. It's a great question. Well, we've got another question up here. Here comes the mic.
Here first.
You're on deck up here, okay?
I'm Hadley, and I...